from Paul's letter to the Colossians. What does he write there? Whatever your task, put yourselves into it as done for the Lord and not for human beings. Whatever your task, put yourselves into it. Now, there will definitely, right, be people at the workplace who believe that we work for them. There will definitely be businesses and companies and clients who believe that we work primarily for them, but the work is for God. And the work is not just paid full-time employment, right? I've talked to many a retiree who said that they're much busier in retirement than they ever were when they were doing full-time employment. Work is not finished when retirement comes. There is no end to work. Work is not done when there's unemployment or when disability comes into our lives. Multiple part-time jobs, that's work. Full-time parenting, that's work. Amen?
Amen.
Full-time parenting is work. Looking for work is work.
Yes.
Volunteering is work. It is all work. And for Christians, again, this is so important. For Christians, the work is not primarily for the employer. It's not for the clients. The work is for God. Now, of course, the paycheck comes from the company. The paycheck comes from the organization. And we are to advocate for safe working conditions and fair pay. In chapter 24 of the book of Deuteronomy, we refer today to the community of Israel as given direction from God through Moses. Employers are not to withhold the wages of poor and needy laborers. It doesn't matter if the employees are members of the community of Israel or foreign workers. Those wages are to be provided. Let's remember this. Deuteronomy was written over 2,000 years ago. And these ancient words from Deuteronomy continue to be needed today, right? You see, this spring in the New Yorker magazine, they featured an article on a Case Farms chicken plant in Canton, Ohio. And the working conditions in this plant in Canton, Ohio, they're extremely difficult. 180,000 chickens are slaughtered there every day. At Case Farms, they produce 1 billion pounds of chicken every year. 1 billion pounds of chicken. And they produce these 1 billion pounds for customers like Kentucky Fried Chicken, Popeyes, Taco Bell, Boar's Head, as well as the federal school lunch program. And Case Farms hires undocumented workers through a contracting agency so that Case Farms is not legally liable. And recently, a 17-year-old, Osiel Lopez Perez, he was working at Case Farms at that plant in Canton, Ohio. And Perez is an immigrant from Guatemala. He was too young to work there, according to law. But he had provided a fake ID in order to get hired when he was 16 years old. Now one day when Perez was sanitizing the machines, he accidentally slipped and he activated one of the machines and he lost his left leg. Now Perez and some of his coworkers, they were fired a few days later. Company rushed to cover up its hiring of undocumented workers and its terrible safety record. You see, the vulnerable teenagers from other countries were punished, but not the executives of the company who knew every immoral detail of what was going on at their plant. Workplaces can be very dangerous. Just a week ago, this past Thursday, a 32-year-old Allentown man, he died after he was injured in a forklift accident, and this was at the Trader Joe's warehouse near Bath. Miguel Amante, he was driving a forklift when he struck a steel post, and he died. In 2005, a member of Metropolitan Community Church, the Lehigh Valley, she died in a workplace accident. Some people here may remember Jolynn Command. She was from Tamaqua. She was 39 years old. She worked as a welder when she tragically passed. And here at MCCLV, as well as Church of the Manger, we have members and friends who have been injured on the job. And I think the city of Bethlehem is really fortunate to have a Lehigh Valley Workers Memorial. Has anyone been there? It's in the Rose Garden. Yes, it's in the Rose Garden at 8th and Union Streets. And according to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, in 2015, workplace fatalities nationwide increased to 4,836 people killed on the job. There are dangers in any workplace. It's not just the dangerous equipment, but unstable co-workers can be an issue. And whatever kind of work we do, whether it's paid work or volunteer work, full-time work or part-time work, we all need prayer for safety. So Labor Day, the first Monday in September, it was started in 1882 by representatives of the labor movement. Labor Day is dedicated to American workers and is a yearly national tribute to the contributions that workers have made to the well-being of the country. And my spouse Carol and I, we will be attending the Labor Day rally tomorrow, and that's going to be at noon, and it's going to be at 7th and Hamilton Streets in Allentown. And we're going to be there in support of fair pay and the dignity of all workers. If you're off for the day, if you're looking for something to do, it would be great to join together and both celebrate workers as well as advocate for workers. And prayers definitely go out to all who will be working on Labor Day. Is anyone here going to be working on Labor Day? Sure. Hospitals don't close down, right? Retail will be open in most places. Law enforcement and other emergency services, those who labor in nursing homes, all are definitely held in prayer. Now, while Labor Day is just once a year, as Christians, we may celebrate the work that God calls us to do every day of the year. You see, every single Christian has a calling, and every single person's calling is wonderfully, beautifully unique. No two Christians are called by God in exactly the same way. Now, some people are lucky to get paid very well to live out their calling. Others receive a calling from God that it may not pay particularly well, and others choose to work in a job that doesn't match their calling, and instead they choose to live out their calling in their volunteer work. There are endless permutations to that, right? Whatever the work, it is all meant in service to God. Whatever the work, God has set work in front of each of us. And it's a calling, and it's a beautiful thing. And what is the work? To serve and to glorify God, whatever we do. The reading from Proverbs instructs us to commit our work to the Lord, and our plans will be established. You see, biblical teaching so often directs us in just the opposite way that the culture directs us. What do we do most often? We make plans, we tell God about our plans, and we thank God for affirming our plans, right? But Proverbs says no. First and foremost, commit your work. Commit our work to God, and then our plans will take root. God comes first, not what we want. And then the more we start putting God first, the more God's desires become our desires. That final scripture reading to focus on today is from Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes, this book, is both profoundly wise and profoundly frustrating. It's an enigmatic and elusive book. It focuses most of all on how humans do not have control. All is vanity, says the writer of Ecclesiastes. He writes, vanity of vanities. He repeats, vanity of vanities. All is vanity. All we humans do is vanity. You see, for the writer of Ecclesiastes, life can only be lived before a sovereign God who determines all that happens on earth. And Ecclesiastes is crushing news for those who consider themselves to be movers and shakers and masters of their destiny. The writer of Ecclesiastes makes it clear that human beings are not in charge. We are not in control. That is all an illusion. God is in control. Even the thought that we may gain something from work is an illusion for Ecclesiastes. It is written, what gain have the workers from their toil? What gain have the workers from their toil? It's similar to a question that's asked in chapter 1 of Ecclesiastes. What do people gain from all the toil at which they toil under the sun? Similar to a question asked in chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes. What do mortals get for all the toil and strain with which they toil under the sun? Now, Ecclesiastes definitely does not mess around with any sort of niceties. The questions are rhetorical. Ecclesiastes puts forth the idea that people gain nothing in the end from their toil. Nothing comes out of the work that we're so convinced makes us whole and worthy and valuable. The work is not what makes us whole and worthy and valuable.
No matter the income we receive, the size of our pension, no matter how many lives we touch, no matter how many people we serve, the work proves nothing to God. It's God alone, it's God alone, it's God alone who makes us whole and worthy and valuable. We don't do the work and then God rewards us. Again, that's backwards. We don't work for 40 years and God gives us a gold watch and God pats us on the back. As Paul writes in Colossians, since you know that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward, you serve the Lord Christ. Instead of doing work to prove ourselves worthy to God, we instead do work, whatever that work may be, whatever the work it is that God has set before us at whatever age or stage of our lives. Instead, we do that work in gratitude to God. We have faith, we trust, we know that we will receive from God the reward of eternal life. And once we know that, we stop serving ourselves, we stop just serving the people we like, we start serving everyone because we are serving the Lord Christ. The same goes like this, it's on the front of our bulletin today. Work for God, the retirement benefits are great. What are the retirement benefits of working for God, for serving the Lord and everything? It's the benefit of the heavenly banquet table, that never-ending feast of love and hope. Thank God that God has it all figured out. Ecclesiastes puts it this way, that which is already has been. That which is to be already is. You know, sometimes Ecclesiastes sounds a little like Yoda from the Star Wars movies, right? Let's look at that line again. That which is already has been. That which is to be already is. You know, some people have said that, some biblical scholars have said that the best way to describe the book of Ecclesiastes is with this phrase. It is what it is. Describe Ecclesiastes. It is what it is. After all, what God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor can anything be taken from it. And we may read Ecclesiastes and start to think, well, if God has it all figured out, then why bother doing anything at all? But look more closely at the start of that reading from Ecclesiastes. It's made very clear at the beginning that there is business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. Oh, okay. God has set work before us. God has set it before us, a calling, a unique calling. And God's gift is that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil, whatever that may be. We are to take joy in our work. It's not for us, right? It's for God. We're not to withdraw and wait and do nothing. We work. God has set work before us, and it's a good and beautiful thing. We work, and what we gain from our work, what we gain from living out our calling, is the assurance of God's eternal promises that we have a heavenly home. And once we recognize this, our labor becomes less burdensome, our work becomes less of a drag. When we make something about God, we become energized. God will always be with you on your continuing spiritual journey. It's not just a life journey. God put each of us on a spiritual journey. And we want more and more of our lives to be about you. Less of us, Lord God, more of you. More of glorifying you with our lives, with our work, with the calling that you have given us, with the gifts that you have given us. You have given each and every person in the sanctuary wonderful, beautiful gifts to share with the world so that more people might know your love. Thank you.